welcome back to AWS On Air, the show where we talk about all the latest and greatest AWS announcements and releases. My name is Nathan Peck. I work as a senior developer advocate at AWS, and I have two folks with me.
Hi, everyone. Super excited to be here with you today in fabulous New York City. My name is Farrah Campbell, and I am a senior product marketing manager at AWS, focusing on containers and serverless. Super excited to welcome our guest today. I'll let you introduce yourself.
Hi, Nick Matthews. I'm a product manager with AWS, and I'm the product manager for Cloudwin.
Okay, so I just learned that it's Cloudwin, not Cloudwan. So I've been saying Cloudwan in my head because I was thinking of like Obi-Wan. And so anyways, my jokes aren't going to work now that it's Cloudwin. So what is Cloudwin?
Yeah, so wide area network, for those of you that aren't network nerds like me. I actually had a European colleague, and he called it Cloudwan. And so a lot of other people called it that too. So
okay, thank you. I'm not the only one.
It is an acceptable pronunciation.
It is. Yeah. So wide area network. A wide area network is just basically it's kind of literal, like it's long networks. So if you have a branch office, or maybe if you're a grocery store, you have hundreds of grocery stores around the country, and you got to connect them all together so that you can do your monitoring, your billing, your all that kind of stuff. So if you're a big company, you need to connect all your things, all your places together. That's a wide area network. So literally wide area.
So the opposite of WAN would be the LAN party. That's when I have all my friends over at my house, and we got our computers hooked up playing games with each other.
Yeah, yeah.
But wide area network would be then if I have my gamer computer hooked up to my friend's computer across the country.
if you were to get a Cat 6 cable across the country, you'd have a WAN.
It would be a very impressive feat.
Yeah.
So obviously, like building that type of like wide area network, like you said, Cat 6 cable across the country, that's not really going to happen if you're like a small shop or even like an independent person. So how can someone build a wide area network these days?
Yeah, and so obviously, AWS and even Amazon as a whole, we have a lot of reasons to run cable all around the world, right?
Yeah.
So we've got undersea cables underneath all the seas, and we've got connectivity all over the place. And so we've already run all those cables. You know, mm-hmm. we're buying and building more cables that go, like I said, under the ocean to connect continents together, sending terabits and terabits of capacity.
I have questions about this, but we'll have to go to those later. Underwater stuff on that.
Okay.
But yeah.
And so what we've really done is we've made it really easy for customers to build their wide area network using our infrastructure, right? So we've got services like transit gateway and network firewall and all these things that you can use to build a network, and then that could all run on top of our actual physical infrastructure and the cabling. And so now we're saying customers like, hey, you don't need to go like buy a bunch of contracts or run cables yourself. Come on AWS, it's all cloud, and sort of do it as you want, pay as you go. And that's kind of the underlying concept of Cloudwin.
So let me know if I get this straight. So folks use wide area networks through AWS because it's easier to set up. They don't have as much of a barrier to entry. They can sort of piggyback on top of all the networking that we were building for our AWS data centers. And we have these different products for it, like VPC peering and transit gateway. So how does Cloudwin, the new service, compare to those or integrate with those?
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously there's a lot of choice when it comes to AWS and how you build networks. So what we've done with Cloudwin is we've really said, like, let's make it easier. And so it's really focused on this sort of simplification. So for example, whenever you want to create a global network, you use a single policy document. So you can do it in JSON, or you can click around the console. I'll show you how to do that later. But essentially, you upload one document, and then the whole network's built, which may actually be something like 30, 50, 100 different API calls if you were to build it yourself. And so it's kind of more of a managed service. And it's particularly if you're doing anything multi-region, it becomes easy. I'll show you, for example, how to expand it from two regions to three regions in like just a couple of clicks.
Let's go ahead and bring up that
yeah.
demo.
Can you also expand a little bit more on what you mean by policy? Like, is that like a traffic policies or?
Yeah, container person, right? You think about other types of policies. So I'll show you what that looks like. So I'll pull this up. And this is a pre-recorded video. I did a little bit of a cooking magic demo here with things bake in a few seconds. So. We go in the console and we just start typing Cloudwin. It shows up in the VPC console as a VPC feature. So here I've got a couple global networks. We're going to create a new one from scratch. And so the global network is not a new concept. We launched that a couple years ago. It allows you to register your transit gateways and other things there. It's more of a, it was really more for visualization. But see, when we go to the next screen here, it's going to see the core network. So this core network is kind of that managed portion I was talking about, where we build the network for you. And so here we'll give this the core network a name, so we're just going to call it Cloudwin. Give it a description or not. These ASNs, that's an autonomous system number. So this is a BGP thing. And so what
this was used for the BGP advertising, so that way the networks can discover each other.
Right, so in theory, usually your whole company is either one ASN, or sometimes every branch site is an individual ASN. Mm-hmm. In this case, we're going to create a network for you running on AWS, and every AWS region is going to get its own ASN.
So
you basically want to give one ASN for every region. And I'm just going from here 65,000 to 65,100 saying, maybe we'll have 100 regions one day. You can modify this.
I hope so.
But I just did something simple. And so then the edge locations are where we're actually going to allow you to create your network. So here I'm going to choose Virginia and Ohio. Oregon. And
I was going to say I choose Oregon too.
So it's multi-choice. I can choose as many edge locations as I want there.
As of today, we went general available. You can do up to 17.
So
you
wow.
Up to 17 regions. And you just press create. And so so now we've got a third new network here. We'll go click on this and see what's going on in the under the hood here. So you can see here there's this pretty topology that's empty right now because nothing's been created yet. If you go to the core network portion, it still says nothing's here yet. So we go take a look at the policy version. So like I said, everything that you configure here is a policy. So here it says there's four steps involved. I'll click on it. And when you come in here and look at the demo, you can actually see that individual steps, almost like CloudFormation, deploying out this network. So it can take 5-15 minutes. This is where the magic comes in. But now we've got a global network in two regions. So I can see the policy version. So what we're going to do now is we're going to add the third region. We're going to say, hey, you know what? We have some use cases to go into Germany. How hard is it to now extend this network into Germany? So you can see some of the things in the policy here. I'm just going to come down here, and I'm going to select the Frankfurt region. And I don't need to give any other information because I already gave it ASNs earlier. I create a policy here. And that's going to generate basically another policy. So under the hood, we're also going to now, we have to validate this and also compare it to the existing network. So before I even deploy anything, I'm going to see what the diff is. And so here, this is saying, that we call it a change set, right? So this change set says I'm adding EU Central 1. When I press apply, this means that now go update the network from the old version to the new version.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can click on this.
And is that update zero downtime? Let's say I have things in all these regions and they're utilizing the wide area network and I want to make a change. Is this going to cause any interruption to?
It depends on the type of change, right? So for example, if you're removing a region.
Yeah, obviously that region's going to be cut off.
Yeah, and there's also some interesting things here I'll show you around like tagging. So one of the things we've done is if you want to create a new VPC or a new VPN or anything, you tag those things, and then it comes into the network. And we look at those tags, and we put it in the right place in the network based on those tags. And so you can actually change, like for example, you can go, I want Sandbox to be Sandbox 2 now. You update that policy change, and it might move a whole bunch of VPCs around the network. So the idea is that, you know, you got a global network, can be kind of scary. So we really want some really strict change control here. For example, this is all different AWS IAM calls. So you could actually say, hey, I want my junior network administrators to be able to create a change set, but I only want the senior network engineers to be able to execute the change set.
Oh, that makes so much sense, yeah.
And you could say, I only want to execute my changes, you know, between 12 and 2 every day. Mm-hmm. And so we've added, like, this is, like I said, it's more the managed service we've done so you can do those types of things and sort of take a little bit of the scariness out of a global network. So here, this change set's executing. I'm just going to refresh after it's finished. So here's actually where you can go see the diff. So I'll say, hey, we're on version 1, we just deployed version 2. I need to go to my change board and tell them what's going to change so they can come here and see exactly what's going to happen. You can do this before the change or after the change or a week later if you need to figure out who messed up the network. So now you can see that we've got a pretty network across three continents.
I like that map. That looks good. I can see that I have different areas connected.
So one of the things we did with the launch is you can take your existing transit gateway network and you can peer it with your Cloudwin network. Because we get this question from customers all the time, which is like, hey, I've got an existing TGW network. What do I do? Do I need to migrate it to Cloudwin? Do I, are you guys going to get rid of it? The answer is no. Like they're both going to live on together. And so, like I mentioned, the global network is something that you were able to do before. And so what this allows you to do is, this view is showing you I've got both transit gateways and a Cloudwin network running. And so they're separated. Mm-hmm. With the feature that we launched today at general availability, you can now peer those networks together. And so you can take your existing network for transit gateways and peer it into Cloudwin. So this, it also enables you to do dynamic routing. So now you can do BGP between your transit gateways through Cloudwin, which is really, really cool. So wow. One of the customer use cases we're seeing a lot of is customers saying, hey, I've got 3-4 transit gateways, one in each region, but man, trying to statically peer these things together is kind of complex. I really wish they would just do dynamic route exchange. Mm-hmm. So what you can do today is you can put a Cloudwin in the middle, peer your transit gateways, and then it's going to do all dynamic routing in between that.
That's fantastic.
It also means it's a kind of an AWS word, but it's a two-way door. So if I started building with transit gateways a couple years ago, and you go, wow, I really want to get into this Cloudwin thing, you're not really stuck. You can go back, you can go and peer that with your Cloudwin network. Or you might say, hey, I built my whole network on Cloudwin, but man, I really need this transit gateway feature. So you can build a transit gateway, use, I don't know, multicast or something more complicated that Cloudwin doesn't have, use it in that one area. We also see this with like large companies where they go, hey, we're trying to get everyone on the corporate network, but there's this one development group, they wear cowboy hats and they've been making money for the company and like they don't follow any of our rules. But like, so we're going to give them their own transit gateway.
Right.
They can do what they want and then just peer it into our larger network over here on this side. And so it's more of like this like kind of federation case that we're
seeing. I have to ask, seeing this topology graph, it's lovely. I love seeing all these connections from one component to another. Does this have an integration yet where I can see like the traffic, how much traffic is going over each route, like observability of the health of these connections?
It's something customers are asking for.
Yeah.
It's one of the things that we're trying not to make this thing too busy either. Mm-hmm. So you can probably expect to see some more work in that area.
Nice.
But right today what you would do is you would click on one of these and it will show you how much traffic is going through, but it's not quite as like the observable pretty graphs you may see.
Yeah.
But you can get the data. It's all in CloudWatch to show that, like, for example, how much bits and bytes are going through individual attachments.
I can click through from here into CloudWatch to access that extra information, such as how, a particular NAT gateway or a transit gateway, how much traffic is going through it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nice.
Yeah, we wanted to say, like, everything we bill you for, we want to show you.
Yeah.
That way you can figure out where the bills are coming from and those kinds of things. So that's one of the things we did think about when we built
it. That makes total sense to me.
Cool. So I'm going to show you how you actually peer a transit gateway into Cloudwin. So this shows you, we've got some networks here, some Cloudwin, some transit gateway. And then we'll go over here into the peerings. So it's really two steps. One is you create the peering connection. The peering connection basically creates a relationship between the transit gateway and Cloudwin. And then once we do that, then we actually also need to create what's called a route table attachment, which I can explain a little bit about that. So I created a new transit gateway called PeerMe. We're going to go create this peering connection. This takes a little bit of time because we're actually going into your transit gateway and doing the peering for you. So it's again, taking away the APIs that you don't need to do. So it took, and this, for me, it took about 10 minutes for it to refresh and finish. Now we're going to go and create the route table attachment. So one of the things is, so all the things you connect to your network are attachments, VPNs, VPCs, et cetera. Same thing with transit gateway. The difference here is Cloudwin has what we call segments, right? So a segment is a dedicated layer 3 network just for that. So for example, a lot of customers will do one for development, one for production, one for shared services, or maybe you're a consulting company and you have two clients, Coke and Pepsi, and they should never talk to each other. And you want them on totally separate networks. and so that's what you can use segments for. And so when you attach your transit gateway to Cloudwin, each route table is a separate attachment. That way you can say, I want this route table to go to this network, I want this route table to go to this network. And so that's why you create a separate attachment for each one of those?
So one of the things that pops in my mind as I look at this is, like, traditionally I've always created the VPC and the attachments and the route table sort of manually by hand in CloudFormation. I type out a bunch of lines of config, right?
Right.
And it looks like this is replacing all of that for me. I just define at a high level, I want this thing to talk to that thing, and it's going to figure out the network configuration for me.
That's one of the core use cases, right? It's like this concept of, like, network teams that want to get to self-service automation.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea is, I create my CloudWAN, I create my policy. Hopefully that policy doesn't change very often. And then I let my developers go tag their VPCs,
mm-hmm.
and it goes into the right network. And so I don't have this in the demo, but you can say that, like, this tag automatically gets approved and goes here. This tag, I have to approve it because, I don't know, it's tagged with PCI or whatever.
And does CloudWAN also have CloudFormation support for its resources? Wow, so now it sounds
to me like...
You can automate
the automation.
Like CloudFormation is going to become simpler. Rather than, like, 1,000 lines of CloudFormation describing the intricacies of my routing table in my network, can create a much smaller and lighter weight CloudFormation description,
right,
for CloudWAN.
Or Terraform too, we have that support as well.
Wow, fantastic.
Yeah. Oh, wow. I love how that's always, like, one of the first questions is, like, does this have CloudFormation support?
When I presented at Transit Gateway years ago at reInvent, I think I only got cheered for one thing, which is, like, we said we had Terraform support and support for all regions. And, like, that was just,
yes,
like, low bar. So yeah, in this case, I'm going to choose my TGW. Excuse me, and the peering. I choose the route table, and this is where I actually go use the tags.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, I'm going to tag it with segment development. I'll show you what this tagging strategy looks like here in a little bit in the actual policy document. So now we create the attachment, and so it's going to go through the same workflow as all the other attachments. We're going to look at the tag, check the policy document, and see what the rules are for that tag. So we can see here that it says it hit policy rule number 100. So I can actually go back and figure out how this actually got associated. So if I go into my latest policy document and I go into the JSON here, so it says that I've got rule number 100 that says tag exists segment, and then basically associate to the value of that key. So it's a little bit verbose here in JSON, but it basically says, if I use the word segment in the tag, whatever the value is, I'm going to look for a segment name called development. So this way, if I have 100 segments, I only need one rule. I can say segment 1, segment 2, segment 3, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And all of this will then automatically map to those segments. If I wanted to create 100 rules, one for each segment, I could do that too. And so this allows us to sort of do that more simply.
And so this policy would also allow you to do higher level things like control which IAM users are allowed to use which segments.
It doesn't get into the IAM. It would say that, like, it's mostly, there's like four or five sections of the policy. It's like kind of the physical topology, like the ASNs and regions.
Mm-hmm.
There's the routing, like I want some static routes here. There's relationships between segments.
Uh-huh.
So you can say that, like, shared services can talk to dev and prod, but prod can't talk to prod. And then the attachment policies. So those are the four main sections of the policy.
I gotta say, I keep trying to say, like, you were really fast on your computer, but I forgot you said that you had this pre-recorded. I'm how are you moving so fast and getting everything done?
It's
like very
online
impressive.
Cooking. Yeah.
Well, this has been really exciting. So, like, where would customers go if they wanted to get started?
Yeah, so the console, just type CloudWAN into the console and you can get started. So yeah, that's the end of the demo. So just showing that this added it to the network. So good time.
I'm pretty sure every AWS user who has a significant network or multiple accounts is going to want to see that topology graph for their own account, because that seems like it's a lot of very helpful information there and really a deep insight into what exactly is going on with networking on my account.
Yeah, we're excited. It's generally available. So a lot of customers have said, like, hey, tell me when it's generally available and I'm going to kick the tires. So that's today.
Fantastic. Well, if you're watching us live on Twitch, go ahead and click the link in the chat and it'll take you through to where you can try out CloudWAN for yourself and see how it works for you. Thank you very much for joining us on the show.
No, thanks for having me.
And look forward to chatting more about CloudWAN in the future.
Yeah, now you know what a wide area network is.